Hi everyone, good afternoon. And now we are going to discuss about dynamic data. So not sure how many of us have heard of the connected web parts in the legacy SharePoint development during the SharePoint 2007 and 2010 development, like when it was in on-prem. This connected web part itself, it was a very big concept, like everyone might have at least once used this connected web part. But after the introduction, after the modern days, the need of the connected web parts has been slowly reduced, but still it was there, right? Most of the time, like nowadays, what happens is all the web parts which we are placing in the site, it's going to act on its own. It doesn't have any need to speak with the other web parts. But in some cases, still we require some of the data needs to be transferred between these two web parts, right? So for those kind of scenario, we have a concept called dynamic data. So that's what we are going to see, how we can implement the dynamic data in SPFX web parts. So are we clear? So that's what we are going to do for the next 40-45 minutes. I'm going to create a new web part, brand new web part. And what we are planning to do is on that web part, like on that solution, there are two web parts is going to be there. One is the source and one is the consumer. So the source, what it does, whatever the parameter which I'm selecting, whatever the data which I'm selecting on the source, I'm passing that, so passing that particular data alone to the consumer web part. And the consumer web part, after receiving the data from the source, it processes that data and it's going to do some manipulation and display it on the screen, or whatever it is going to do, let it do. So this is what the demo which we are planning to do today. So let me show you, let me quickly stop this sharing and let me start sharing my VM. Okay, hope you are able to see my VM, right? Vijay, is it visible?
Yeah.
Okay. So what we are doing is we have two web parts. As I said, this one is the first web part that we can consider it as a source, and this is the second web part. It is the consumer. Whatever on the from the source, I have a list of information, and when I choose this information, this web part, like the data which has been selected, the selected city, it has been transferred from the city, you know, like the first web part, to the second web part, the consumer web part. And the consumer web part, what it does, it is displaying the temperature. It's again, by receiving the city name, it makes an API call and it's displaying the weather of that particular city. So that's what the demo which we are planning to do today. And for that, as usual, let me go ahead and create. Yeah, let me stop this one. It'll take few minutes. So let me create a brand new solution. Okay, and the solution name, let it be cities and temperature, and I'm targeting, use the current folder. Don't want it get to be required. Yeah. So what I can do is the source, right? City source. The list of cities will be available. Okay. Let's make it as a React framework. Let it create. It's a step-by-step process. What I am planning to explain is, let's create the two web parts. One is the city source and one is the consumer. Let us call it as consumer web part or whatever it is. And then let's add few of the cities into the source web part and create a drop down, bind that particular state into that drop down. That's it. I thought of creating the solution, but I just wanted to show all the steps without any some smaller steps to be missed on this demo. That's the reason we are creating the solution itself. Or else today morning also I created another solution for this one. I don't want to use the same thing. Let's do it from the scratch. Bear with me for a few minutes. And during the time of it gets created, let me try to explain what the background, how it works. Like basically, all the web parts and all the logics, all the events. So far, many of us might be writing all the things in our TSX file itself. That is the component file itself, right? Whoever is writing the SPFX web part. I have seen many developers who writes all their logics into that component itself. For them, the webpart.ts file, it is nothing but a container to hold the TSX. And that web part, that TSX may have n number of other TSXs. But all the events, whatever the events with respect to that component, they have written everything inside the TSX itself, that is the component file itself. But in general, like if at all anything needs to be transferred across the component, then you need to make it as a generic one. So what is the generic container? As everyone knows that the webpart.ts file is the generic container. So here, like I'm going to implement a particular component like iDynamic data callable. It is nothing but it's already there in your node module itself. We are going to implement that one on this particular web part. So once you implement that, obviously the properties like get property definition, get property value, these are all the methods which is there in that particular interface, iDynamic data callable. So these two methods we need to implement. We need to create these two methods, and then the events, whatever the event which is happening, like whenever I'm changing the value on the dropdown, some like on dropdown change event, it happens, right? So on changed event, that on changed event, we should not write it on the TSX itself. What we need to do, we need to pass that event as a property to the TS file, that is the web part file. Then from the web part, I'm going to notify the SharePoint framework. That is how it works. Like at a higher level, how it works is we have a source web part and the consumer web part. And the source web part, there is some change happened on the source web part. And that web part, what it does, it is notifying the framework. It is notifying the SharePoint framework, right? It is not directly communicating with your consumer web part. It is directly communicating with your framework. And this consumer web part, it has been already subscribed for that particular event. And as soon as the framework receives a notification, the framework intimates the consumer, hey, this data has been changed by the source. You can start working on your one. Like your property has been modified. So that is how it works. So let us see it in detail once we get created. So now what happens? The solution got created. Let's open the solution. Okay, I have a web part called a city source, right? Now let's add another web part. This shouldn't take much time. What we can name this, we can name it as consumer. Mm. since because we made a spelling mistake in city source, the same thing I just want to maintain in the consumer also. Okay, let's see that. We got the source and consumer. As we said, the source web part, what are all the things which is going to be there? It's a blank source web part. That's it. So as usual, let's go and give a gulp, sir. For this particular demo, I'm not at all going to use any of the SharePoint data. What we are planning to do is we will populate this information. And for us, the local workbench is more than sufficient. We don't need the SharePoint workbench. So let's open that. Okay, that's great. I have two web parts. One is the source and the other one is the consumer. Okay, both the things are same. What we can do is, as we said, let's go back and let's fix the source first. Okay, and before that, what I'm going to do is let me add a new folder data, and inside that let's create a new file, an interface. It's nothing but ict.ts. Okay, and I'm going to export this. Let's have a two property here. So this particular interface I'm going to use throughout this application. Okay, so on this, let me add one more state. Okay, so all of us might be knowing the difference between the state and props, right? If at all I want to use some data within the same component, I'll go for a state. And when I want to share the data among the component or from the web part file to the component file, I will go with the property. So in our case, the information about the selected city and the temperature, so these kind of information where I can store, I can keep everything in the state itself. But the event, like which is going to be like I'm going to implement a new dropdown, and that dropdown on change event should be handled by the TS file, not from the TSX. So in that case, I will create, I'll transfer this particular event between a component and a web part. For that, I need to use the props, right? So with this basic understanding, let's go ahead and create the state. On the state, as I said, I'm going to have two things. One is the list of cities and one is the selected city. So and the list of city, I'm keeping it in an array. Okay, let us, we need to import. So this one always I have some doubts. So whenever I have some doubt, we will write. Sorry, someone asked any doubt. Okay, so the city, I created the source state, and let's create the source property. Let's have a look on the props as well. On the props, as of now, I'm not going to make any changes. So let it be as it is. But here, after some time, what we are planning to do, we need to add one more event here, right? Let me keep a placeholder for it. Add the event handler for the drop down on changed event. Okay, so let us come back to this one. In the meanwhile, let's go back to the TSX, and I need to, like, we are planning to add some data, right? So the data where we can add, always the component did mount. I have a few of the things. Yeah, here again, let's add that one, add the state. Okay, why it is not coming, the state? Okay, so always there is a confusion. Let me have it. Okay, and in the render, let's add a drop down. Before adding, I need to import this drop down menu. Okay. And the options, I'm going to bind this option. So we had a list of cities, right? And the styles, we don't want the style, importantly unchanged. Okay, unchanged, what we can do is this dot on city changed. I'm going to keep as usual. By default, what we will have, all the developers will have a method here. This is going to return nothing, and this is what, and I'm going to have the same thing, event and the selected city, I'm passing it. Let's alert, do an alert. This is what it has been. This dot state dot cities of selected city dot text. I have two things, right? One is the key and the value. So let's see why the cities is not coming on the state. Okay, cities, it has been populated. It's right. And this should be having a value. Okay, but here what we forgot is on the, like, whenever we are introducing, we need to inherit this one also, right? Okay, once I receive, let me create a constructor of the props. And let's initiate the state here. Going to give a blank city. Okay, so always there is a confusion on the city tie. Okay, and once this is done, what will happen is, what I need to do is I need to populate this state, right? But usually what we will do, we will make any of the API call and all these things in which method, like all these things will happen on the component did mount, right? So I'm leveraging the same component did mount. And here what we can do, instead of calling any of other APIs, simply I'm going to populate the data, that's it. Okay, so what data we are going to populate? Only the cities, it's going to be in JSON, right? I have a key value pair. Similarly, let's have few more cities. London or Mumbai. Okay, so as of now, what we have done is we have created the source web part. That's it. And now let's ensure that the source web part works fine. Okay, it has a drop down and all these things. As soon as I select that one, it's our alert and our event is also working. So what I'm doing is select. Okay, just to ensure that the same kind of event, I'm going to create it on the TS file. Okay, from the TSX file, the event got triggered. Okay, that's perfect. Now let's see how we can transfer this particular event, and this event should be handled on the source web part, right? On the source web part, let me create a new method. That's it. What I'm going to create, it's going to be like the same on city changed or whatever it is. And this again, the same thing. Defining. Okay. And what we can do is this particular event is expecting, or the method or even whatever you can call, it's expecting a parameter. What it is, I'm going to, as usual, I'm going to implement this import the ICT. Okay, once this on city change, what we are going to do as of now, as what I'm not going to do anything, I'm just going to alert this one, alert of city.key or text, whatever it is. Okay, and this one, just to differentiate whether our event got transferred properly. So to transfer this event, how we can, only the props is the only way. So on the props, I'm going to add one more event, one more property on city changed. This is the property which I'm adding it. What it does, it's taking the parameter, okay, and what it is going to return, it's not going to return anything. And as usual, we will import the city. Okay, so this this particular event, I created it as a property here, and let's go back to the web part. And from the web part, I need to pass this. So how are we going to pass? There's one more property called onCityChanged, right? So that's the property which we had. For this, I have now we will make this one. Okay, so I'm passing this particular property. A property is nothing but, again, it is an event, and the value, once it occurs, this onCityChange, it is nothing but it'll get triggered from my TS file instead of that one. Okay, so in the same manner, to call this one, what we need to do, we will go back, and on this onChanged, what we are going to do, we are going to call the method from the TS file. So how we are going to call it, we are passing it the event, that is the sender, and the object, okay, here the props will have that one on city change, and here I'm going to pass the selected city alone. Okay, and okay, we made a mistake. Give me a minute, we can fix it out. No. Let's wait for a minute. It's getting reloaded. Yeah. From the TS file. Now you can see what we have done. The event, the onChanged event, we transferred the onChanged event from the TSX to the TS file. It has been handled from the TS file. That's what, why I'm insisting so many times, is these kind of the data, like whenever you deal with the communicating between the web part or communicating between the component, it's very, very important to deal everything in your web part.ts. So far, we might have not familiar with that, dealing on that. Like, the best practice is keeping all your events and all the centralized methods into the web part.ts. That's what the primary rule with the SPFX, but most of us were not following, just because of the ignorance or just because of the timeline. We will try to keep everything in the TSX file, but that's not the best practice. We should try to keep as much as we can do it in the TS. Okay, so that's one. With that, what we can see, this is how it has been moved. Okay, so now the source web part, we are very clear, and let's move on to the consumer web part. So as of now, let me close all the consumer source related web part files. Let's make few things about the consumer. Consumer part, it's very simple. And what it all is going to do, there is only one difference we have. Only one major change we are going to do in the consumer part. We are going to add one more property on the property pane. That's it. On that particular property, we will map the source web part. That when it will happen, after adding the web part on the screen, we can do that configuration. But as of now, let's see, like, let's make the other API call and ensure that whatever the value we pass, it is giving back our temperature related stuff. So those things we will see. Okay, and as usual, let's add one more state. I prefer using state. So like, what are all the things going to be there in the props? Nothing special. We have the description, and I'm going to add one more property here. That is the dynamic data property. We can come back to this. But for this state, what are all the things I can have? I'm interested in the city and the temperature. So obviously I will be having the city and the temperature, right? Give me a minute. Yeah. Okay, let me quickly copy that, right? So I have the consumer state. Like before that, city consumer state, that's it. Okay, and then similarly, what we can do is, let's ensure that on the property, what property we have, we are not at all going to do anything special on this props as of now. But when we try to establish the connection between the source and target, definitely we are going to add a new property here. What is the property is going to be? It is going to be the dynamic property. Let's see in a couple of minutes. And then let me go to the consumer web part here, consumer TSX. Yeah. Let me remove this and add a separate div. And temperature in the city. What is the city? This dot state dot. What is the value which I have on the state? City and the temperature. Okay. Right. City is this dot state dot temperature. And this two things to get it work. What I need to do? I need to import the state object. So these are all the default items. So we don't need to worry much about this. Okay. So as usual, once we import these things, here also I need to create few of the props. Let's move on to the constructor. Initiate the state. All these things are by default, right? The temperature, I'm keeping it as a null value. On the component did mount, let's populate these values. So until then, I don't want to keep this one. Okay, and let's have the component did mount. All of us might be familiar with the page lifecycle, right? First it will go to the render, as usual, the constructor, component did mount, component did update, all these things, it will come. So component did mount is the event. Usually we will make all our API calls to populate the whatever the value which is required to be shown on that particular web part. We will take advantage of this component did mount. As soon as all the components in this particular file gets loaded, this event will get triggered. So what's the advantage of it? We can use those states and props here, and this is the place where you will populate your state object. Okay, so let's see what are all the things which I have here. let me quickly copy this. Before that, I have another method called get temperature. Okay, so let me type that first. Okay, so I have the get temperature. Don't worry about this API and all. This is a free API where you can pass. If you pass any of the city, it will give you this API. So the target of this session is not discussing about this APIs and all, how we are going to establish the connection between the source and the consumer. So here what we are planning to do, let me quickly call this. Okay, right. And the city, we will again import the city. One sec. Import the city. Okay. Done. That's it. This is what I have. Why the constant city does not exist in the read only consumer props? Okay, this one should be the dynamic property. Okay, let it be till that time. Yeah, so for implementing this one. Okay, that's it. And as I said, the TSX file, it doesn't have anything much. What we have done so far on the render, I'm going to render a particular value. Like I'm interested in two state objects. The first one is the city and second one is the temperature. And where these two state objects were populated on the component did mount. And on the component did mount, from where I'm getting the value of the city, from the property, and the temperature, I'm going to get the temperature. This that set state of the temperature I'm populating based upon my calculation or my process, but the city I'm assigning this value from this property. So hence the property should have the dynamic property. So this is what I was referring earlier. Let's create a new property. And the type of that property is going to be dynamic property. And what is the value which is, what is the type which is going to keep in itself? It's the iCT. For this, what we need to do, we need to import both iCT. Yeah, iCT is the type or class or interface. Okay, and the second one, what we can do is I'm going to import the dynamic property from the default node module at Microsoft/SP component base. Yeah. Okay, so these are all the two things which we have done, and on the web part on the TSX. Now this is gone. Okay, that's perfect. We are done with the consumer component. But as I said, the last step, what we need to do, we need to update or modify the property pane, right? So I don't want the property pane field as a description. Along with this, what I want is, I want one more dynamic data property. What it is? So, let me update the property pane configuration. Okay, so I need to add few of like the import components are missing. Let's add them. It's not a big deal. Okay, and the dynamic property. From the property pane node module, we'll include the dynamic data field as well. Okay. So now it will go out. Okay. So now the consumer web part, it is 100% completed. What are all the things we have done? We know how to get the value from the props, and we'll, like what we did, we based upon that prop value, I'm populating, I'm doing some calculation. The method is called getTemperature, and the output of that method, again, I'm storing it in a separate state, and these two state values, the city and the temperature, I'm displaying it on my web part. That's it. And to do that, to get the value called city, like as a property, I'm introducing a new dynamic property pane field. So what it is I'm declaring it as the city, and this city, this property will be populated or will be consumed from the SharePoint framework once the source notifies the framework. Okay, I hope it will be a bit confusing. Let's wait for 5 more minutes. We will complete that one, so it will be very clear. Okay, so now let's go back to the source web part. And as I said, hereafter, what our focus is all about, we don't need to focus on the TSX. What all we need to do is we need to focus only on our TS file. So TS file, like I'm going to inherit one more thing. Instead of this base client side web part, I'm going to inherit, like as I said, we are going to implement the dynamic data callables, right? So that dynamic data callable, let's see how we are going to implement it. Okay, the first thing what I'm going to do is I'm going to import them. Okay, I'm going to import this dynamic data. Once I import it, I'm going to implement the iDynamic data callable. Okay, so once we implement this one, our solution or our class will become a throw an error. Why? Because we need to implement those two methods which I said. Like what are they? There are two methods which for sure needs to be implemented. The first one is the get property definition and get property value. Okay, instead of writing it, let me quickly copy paste here. Okay. Right, get property definition. It's nothing but I'm going to define my property. As I said, I have two property. One is the ID and title. So, and the get property value, what it does is it's going to return this selected city. And I'm the selected city is the local variable which I declared. Okay. Right. Now, what the max, what we did, we implemented one of the interface and we make like we defined the methods which has been declared on that interface. What are those two methods? One is the get property value and one is the get property definition. And as the method name itself clearly says that here, that property definition, I have only two property, ID and title, and the property value, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass this one. That's it. Okay, the property ID equal to, if the property ID is city, I'll show you this one, how this city is being populated and when this selected city will be called out. Okay, and with this particular changes, there is no more change required on this particular web part, and the rest of the things we have already seen, we have already saw these things. And only other thing is, after this alert, as I said, this particular web part, it is not going to pass the data directly to the consumer web part. What it does, it will inform SharePoint framework that this is what the data modified. Okay, to inform that on the city change, what we need to do, this dot context always refers to the web part context. That's why we are handling. Now all of us might be able to correlate why I moved that event to the web part, because on the TS file only we will get the this.context, that is the webpart.context. And as usual, you can ask the same question, like, why can't we pass the context to the TSX? Yes, that is also possible. We can pass the webpart context to any of the component from the webpart file as a property. Yes, agreed. Again, if we pass the context, the rest of the methods or the rest of the implementation which we did, get property definition, get property value, so these methods will be stored or they will be written on the TS file. That's the reason I wanted that event to be to also be handled on the TS instead of the TSX. Okay, so let me have, this is what the method is called, notify property changed. This is what the entire magic it has been happened. Like this notify property changed, what it will do, it will inform that, this is going to inform SharePoint framework that event or a property has been modified. Okay, that's what it is all about. Now it's very clear, right? What we have on the city change, I'm calling a method, or I'm consuming a method called the notify property changed, and on that I'm passing the property, that is the property is city is the property which has been changed, and this is the line which will make SharePoint framework understands that the source, there is a data change happened on the source web part. Okay, so with this, let's go back. And we will do only one thing. The last thing, we need to initialize the source. So the initialization always will happen on the onInit method. Okay, onInit, what it does, it's going to be, it's not going to return anything. Okay, right. And this is what the initialization method, again, this dot context dot dynamic data source manager dot initialize source. What is the source? This particular web part, the current web part is going to be the source. And what we can return, return dot promise, I'm resolving the promise. Okay, right, that's it. Okay, all these things we have done so far, right? Get the property value and the render method. Okay, all the property pane, it's been done. Now let's see, if you have a look on it, I have few of the things. Okay, and from the TS file it's loaded, still it is not populated. Why it is not populated? We need to edit the consumer web part and connect to the source. Which source? City source is the like, and which is the property? This is what the property, and I can have the city's properties, right? Let me save this. Let's edit. City source is city. Okay. It should get passed. Give me a minute. Okay. I think since because it's been added in the workbench, I have few confusion. Give me a minute. Let's try to debug it. Okay, there's no exception, but the data is not transferring properly from the source to target. Give me a minute. Okay. Okay, this is why it is not coming. Okay, we need to pass this. Yeah, otherwise this particular thing, it is coming up to this web part. Hope you would have seen, like I have the property called the city, but this property, like I haven't, I forgot to far, like I forgot to send this property to my TSX. So TSX is where actually the core functionality is happening, right? In the city consumer.tsx, this is where the property city should come. But we missed it to pass that one. That's the reason the value was not populating. But okay, here if you could see, when I change this one, it will. Okay, at least this should. Yeah, by default, I gave the default value as Chennai. And when I change this value should get populated. Why it is not getting populated? Give me a minute. Okay, probably we might be missed. Pass the value. Once again, let me check. Okay. So at a high level, this is how it works. Like we have a step-by-step process in the docs.microsoft.com. That's it from my end.